Good morning and welcome to Macquarie Chapel Presbyterian Church. It's great to have you with us this morning. Wasn't yesterday lovely? There was this bright yellow thing in the sky, and it was a lovely, wasn't actually the loveliest of days, but it didn't rain, so it was a nice change. But we're back at it this morning, obviously. So those of you who are joining us on the live stream, we fully understand why. You may not have ventured out this morning, but welcome to those who are present and also those who are on the live stream. We've had some technical problems this morning already. Thankfully, Sharon's fixed the clock, so we should finish at 9:30. But the clicker's not working either, so I will be pretending the clicker works, and Sharon will be responding likewise, appropriately up the back. I've got screen down the front here, so you start going with the announcements and I'll see what they are and I can tell people. Next one, and next one, you will need rejoicing books if we don't have screens, that's correct. That's why we have Margaret, yep. A reminder, gentlemen, for the MacChaps evening at Rowan's place. You've still got time to RSVP to that if you have not yet. Thanks, Sharon. Financial update as of the end of February. Our general giving budget to date was $54,000. That's, of course, to be approved at the meeting on Wednesday, our annual congregational meeting. So the actual giving, though, was about $8,265 below where we were on budget. But that means that we have improved slightly from our January position. The building fund, budget to date, $9,000. Giving so far has been $6,200, which puts us a little less than $3,000 behind, but we had a surplus at the end of last year, so we're doing all right there. Just so that you know as well, this will be in the reports for the annual general meeting, but as of the 28th of the 2nd, our loan remaining with ministry mission was just over $160,000, once again coming down from $250,000. So thank you to you for your generosity. Next slide, thank you, Sharon. So just a reminder of that the annual general congregational meeting is on Wednesday evening at 7:30 p.m. And I believe that we've emailed out reports as of the end of last week, the papers for that. And are there any available here this morning?
Yes.
Yes, there is. And some people have them. Excellent. So you've got something to read during the sermon. So that's a bit of a worry. Some of you have something to read right now. But anyway, I'll keep going. Next slide. Thank you, Sharon. The church that we're praying for this week, each week we endeavour to pray for one of the local churches other than us. So Harbour City Church seems to be a relatively new church that's come up. By the way, this is about the 24th church that we've prayed for, and we still haven't come back to the beginning yet. Pray for Pastor Jim and his wife Claudia Jung and the ministry team of Harbour City Church. Pray for the various ministries, including men, women and children's ministry. And also, one of their workers, or he's an intern there, Sinjin Yang, attended our last Together for Ride meeting. He's working at Macquarie Uni with students there, and so it was good to meet him. So if you want to pray for them, they're doing some great work in our local area. Also, we wanted to ask you, I'm sure many of you, we prayed last week for the situation in the Ukraine, but the Moderator General of the Presbyterian Church of Australia has announced an appeal for Ukrainian refugees. So if you would like to give to that, then please, you're able to do that. You can do that electronically, of course, but we can also give you some more information about how it is that you might do that directly if you'd like to do that to help Ukrainian refugees. Thank you, Sharon. That is it in the way of announcements. Our call to worship this morning. Come now, and let us reason together, says the Lord. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool. Let's pray. Almighty God, unto whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Let's stand and sing our first hymn this morning, which is number 9. Number 9, screen's still not working for you. They are working? They're not working. So you'll need your Rejoice hymn book. It's number 9. Comes straight after number 8. Number 9, O Worship the King, O Glorious Above.
And confession. Heavenly Father, we come here today to worship you, source of all love and grace, creator and sustainer of the universe. Let us put out of our minds all the cares and worries of the week and those things that make us anxious and afraid, so that we with joyful hearts can bring to you our praise and thanks. We thank you for the coming of Jesus Christ into our world, for the new teachings he brought that changed the order of things to come down across, and information to come down across the ages to our own time, challenging our actions and beliefs. We thank you for his death and resurrection and the promise of eternal life. We thank you for our friends and family and all the joy and laughter we share with them. As we worship you, O Lord, we are conscious of the many ways we have failed you. Forgive us the times that we have been filled with anger and bitterness. Forgive us the times when we have been too concerned about money and material possessions. Forgive us those things for which we are ashamed. Forgive us our inability to recognize your presence. Forgive us our deafness to your teaching. Forgive us our reluctance to follow your lead. Forgive us when you want to send us out, but we refuse to go. Help us to live in unity with those around us in this time of great change. Help us to be generous in our dealings with others, respecting other points of view, and using them to enlarge our vision. In these things we pray, the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, hallowed be your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, the power, and yours, ever and ever. Amen.
Before I read this morning, just a little note about Bernice Breer. She had another fall, and she's in Royal North Shore Hospital in a very serious condition. That's the current update from Jim, her eldest son, who rang me the other night to let me know. This morning's reading is from Matthew, and it's a pretty tough ask when you read it and think about it, how it would apply to you today. It's from Matthew 18, and it's from verse 21 to 35, and it starts, "Then Peter came up and asked him, 'Lord, how often am I to forgive my brother if he does me wrong? As many as seven times?' Jesus replied, 'I do not say seven times, I say 70 times seven. The kingdom of heaven, therefore, should be thought of in this way. There was once a king who decided to settle his accounts with the men who served him. At the outset, there appeared before him a man whose debt ran into millions. Since he had no means of paying his master, he was ordered to be sold as a slave to satisfy his debts. His wife and children also were to be sold, and everything that he had. The man fell prostrate at his master's feet. 'Be patient with me,' he said, 'and I will pay you in full.' And the master was so moved with pity that he let the man go and remitted his entire debt. But no sooner had the man gone out, he met with a fellow servant who owed him just a few pounds. And catching hold of him and gripping him by the throat, he said, 'Pay me what you owe me.' The man fell at his fellow servant's feet and begged him, 'Please be patient with me, and I will pay you.' But he refused, and he had this man jailed until he should pay his debt. The other servants were deeply distressed when they saw what had happened, and they went to their master, and they told him the whole story. He accordingly sent for the man. 'You scoundrel,' he said to him, 'I remitted the whole of your debt when you appealed to me. And you will, weren't you bound to show your fellow servant the same pity that I showed you? And so angry was he that he had this man tortured until he should pay his debt. And that is how my heavenly Father may deal with you, unless you each forgive your brothers from here on in. Amen.
Let's stand and sing our next hymn for this morning, which is 571, Teach Me Your Way, O Lord, Teach Me Your Way. This morning we continue in Matthew's Gospel, and we just had read for us Matthew 18, 21 to 35. Last week we did the Transfiguration in chapter 17, and I mentioned that it had been a passage that I hadn't preached on before. I was trying to challenge myself. When I came to Matthew 18, there's lots of stuff in Matthew 18, and there's lots of challenging stuff as well. And I was thinking, well, which challenge do I take on for this Sunday? And so I arrived at a parable, and the idea of the unforgiving servant, and in some ways it's a confronting parable that Jesus tells, and I thought it might be helpful for us this morning. To begin with, let me remind you that on Wednesday we have our annual general meeting, and for the annual general meeting there has been our auditor has prepared, our treasurer has prepared financial reports, and the auditor has made sure that everything is accurate. The auditor has gone through everything to make sure our bookkeeping is correct and make sure that when we said we got this, that we did, and when we paid this, we did, and there's receipts and there's et cetera, et cetera. That's right. The exciting world of accounting. Andrew, welcome this morning. Andrew works for a bank. It's great to have you with us this morning. The important world of bookkeeping. It's a world that often our eyes can glaze over, and on Wednesday night, some of us eyes may glaze over as we look at financial reports and budgets and so forth, and yet some find it exciting. There's the precision. Where did every last cent go? You know what good bookkeeping's like, isn't it? Like, to be a good bookkeeper, you can't just go, "Oh, well, it was about this, can you? You've got to be accurate." And that's what the parable is about this morning. It's about people who are incredibly accurate with their bookkeeping. Verse 21, Peter, before the parable is told, comes to Jesus and says, "Lord, how many times should I forgive my brother when he sins against me? Up to seven times," he asks, thinking, I guess, maybe that's generous. And Jesus responds, as per Genesis chapter 4, you can look that up in your own time if you like, with something that the version Jim read for us, I believe, is to be the more accurate one. Not, "I tell you, seven times seven." Sorry, not seven times, but 77 times. Jesus actually says not seven, but 70 times seven. So it's not actually 70. It's how many? Near enough. Four. So not an accountant. So 490 to be precise, which makes you wonder really what Jesus' point was. Was it when you have somebody who is your good friend and does the wrong thing by you 490 times that the 491st time you bring the hammer down? Is that what Jesus is saying? I don't think so. That's ridiculous, isn't it? I think Jesus is saying the amount of times you should forgive your brother should be to the point that you're actually not record keeping, you're not bookkeeping at that point. He says, no, you forgive a lot. You don't keep a good record of profit and loss. Instead, you forgive. Well, in verse 23, Jesus starts to tell the parable. He says, "Therefore, the kingdom of heaven is like a king who wants to settle accounts with his servants." See, he's a bookkeeper. He's going to settle his accounts. This is about bookkeeping. And he says, "I want to work out who owes me what, so that what they owe me, they can pay me. And if they don't owe me, then they don't have to pay me." He was a fair king. He was wanting to settle accounts. Now, I used to, in a previous life, work as a credit manager. I used to chase bad debts. It was one of the things that I used to do. I just happened to do it for a Christian company as well. It was an interesting line of work, and at the end of the financial year, we had to do our best to settle accounts. We had to work out which people would pay, in which case we would keep asking them for money, and those who were just not going to pay, in which case we would stop asking for them for money and write their debt off. And so that would have been a part of the process that this king has knowingly entered into. He's dealing with his accounts. Who will pay? Who will not? What will he do with those who cannot pay? It's just standard bookkeeping. Let's have a look at the debt that this man owes in verse 24. 10,000 talents. A talent is actually a measurement of weight. One talent is a little bit less than 60 kilograms. There would be some people here who would be possibly less than a talent. I'm much more than a talent. But there's some of you who might weigh less than a talent, and so it's a weight. It's a weight of silver or gold. In other words, it's a lot, because this person owes how many? 10,000 times 60 kilograms. 10,000 times, it was believed that one talent would actually take you 20 years to earn. And so that's just one talent. So 10,000 talents at 20 years of wages is how many years of wages? 200,000 years of wages. It's a huge astronomical debt. In fact, it's a ridiculous debt, isn't it? And I think that's Jesus' point. This debt is just ridiculous. It's well past the 70 times 7, the 490 times. It's something that somebody would take many lifetimes to pay back. But this king is a good accountant. And so he's going to do things by the book. And in verse 25, It says, since he was not able to pay, because we read that the servant said, please, you know, have patience with me. The king says, or the master says, since he was not able to pay, the master ordered that he and his wife and his children and all that he had be sold to repay the debt. You see, this master, it says servants in some translations, but it's more accurate to say slaves, really. These people were owned. And so when I was a credit manager, one of the things that we could do is quite legitimate, but I said I worked for a Christian business, and so they never went all the way through with doing this. They threatened it. But it's quite legitimate in today's society, if somebody owes you a debt, to get a ruling on that debt and to have the sheriff back you when you go and you seize property to the value of that debt. When I say to the value of that debt, it's actually property that would have cost a lot more than that debt, but you're allowed to seize as much as you need to reasonably sell to pay for the debt. Now, for us, we don't seize humans and sell them, but back in this time when Jesus was telling the story, slaves were owned by somebody. And so this master owns these slaves, and so it is well within his rights to say, well, I will sell you and your wife and your children. Now, note that there's no way that their lives would have covered the debt that was actually there. And so he was going to take a loss, but he was going to completely liquidate the assets. He was going to sell all of the family and everything that they owned so that he could be a good bookkeeper. Like I said, I worked for a Christian company when I was working as a credit manager and was involved in debt collection. And there were times when I would always go to my boss and I would ask him, these people aren't paying, they've refused to pay, they owe this much debt, what would you like to do? And if there was a large debt, then ultimately we would go to the point of going through the law courts and having permission to essentially break down doors and seize goods so that we could sell them. And every time we got to that point, if they still hadn't paid, because you never knew, they might pay right up to the very end. My boss, when I said, well, are we knocking down the door? He would always say, no. And it used to frustrate me as a young guy. It's like, come on, when are we going to do this? It's actually not good business sense and not good accounting to not do everything you can to recover your debt. But it's interesting, if you look at the servant, did you see what he says in verse 26 as he realizes that he's going to be sold along with his wife and children into slavery to an unknown master who may be a lot worse than his current master? He says in verse 26, be patient with me and I will pay back everything. It's a ridiculous statement, because he can't unless he does very well at the races or in lotto or some business scam. But he's not going to do it just by normal means, not by hard work, not by an honest sort of way. But notice what he's doing here. There's a couple of things that are interesting. One is that he is still trying to work on a normal accounting sort of basis. I still owe you the debt and I will repay it. If you're a good accountant, master, I can be a good accountant too. If you want to be repaid for your debt, that's a good accounting, profit and loss and everything else. Well, I will give you what you are owed. That's good bookkeeping. That's good business. I can do this. Notice that he asks for one thing. It's not the bravest thing he could ask for, but it's the accounting thing that he asks for. He says, be patient. He asks for patience. Do you notice what he doesn't ask for? Forgiveness. He doesn't ask the king, the accountant, the chief accountant, can you please forgive me my debt? Instead, he says, could you just have patience with me? And this is still trying to follow the rules of bookkeeping. Have you noticed? But as we move on, verse 27, Jesus says that the servant's master took pity on him. and he cancelled the debt and he let him go. Notice what happens. The man didn't ask for forgiveness. He didn't ask for a cancelling of the debt. He asked for patience. But this accountant king who knows that things need to be weighed up looks at him and goes, well, it's never going to get weighed up. It is never going to get weighed up. He's asked for patience, but I could have all the patience in the world. It's never going to get reconciled. And so he says, I'll wipe the debt. And the very thing that he hadn't asked for, he gets. A complete wiping of the debt, complete cancelling of the debt, forgiveness in full. And notice what verse 27 says. It says, the servant's master took pity on him. You'll notice the word that's translated as pity is used in Matthew 20:34, as well as Mark 1:41. In both those verses, and Matthew 20:34 is just a couple of pages over, you might want to check it out, but they're used to describe a reaction that Jesus has. We've talked about this before. It's compassion. And so Jesus tells a parable that describes, as we've, I hope, come to realize over the last few weeks, is the very heart of Jesus himself. He represents the master. The master is the Father. It's him. Instead of patience, he grants forgiveness because he has compassion on him. He cancels the debt. Do you notice what the good king accountant does at this point? He now becomes a very bad accounting king because he throws the books out. Did you notice that? Up until that point, the king has at each and every point gone, I'm going to settle my accounts. People owe me this. I will be given this. And if they don't owe me this, then I will sell them and everything they own so that I will be given what is owing to me. But now instead he goes, he gets asked for patience. Patience would keep the books there. But no, instead he says, you know what? And he just tears out those pages of the books and he throws them away and says, it's cancelled. I've talked before about this great description of love in 1 Corinthians 13. And in verses 5 and 6 of 1 Corinthians 13, it says, love is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. It throws the books out. Doesn't delight in evil. It rejoices in the truth. It understands there's a right and a wrong. And it loves good and it has a real issue with evil, and yet it also keeps no record of wrongs. This is something that we find confusing and hard to balance up and understand. Well, that's not the end of the parable, is it? It takes a real turn, doesn't it? Jesus is the master storyteller. So what happens when this servant who's been forgiven... Let me look at my notes just to make sure. 200,000 years worth of wages. What is it that he does when he has the opportunity to balance his books? Well, he would appear to be an accountant to the very core, because he decides when he meets a fellow servant or slave who owes him something that he is going to demand full payment. Now, in the parable, it tells us that the other man owes 100 denarii. Now, it just so happens that in a couple of chapters' time, Jesus is going to tell another parable. And in that parable, he describes a person who is employed for a day. And do you know how much he was employed for that day? 1 denarii. So this man owes him around about 100 days' work. So somewhere between a quarter to a third of a year is what this man owes. In other words, it's not insignificant, is it? If you owed me that sort of money, I'd like you to pay me. It's not an easy thing to let go of, and yet at the same time, compared to this man's debt, which was he would never be able to pay off, it's quite achievable, really, isn't it? Now, the question is, does he treat this fellow servant the way that the master was going to treat him? It's very tempting to say yes, but there's actually a bit of a difference, isn't there? Do you remember what the master was going to do to him? He was actually going to use him as collateral to pay off the debt. but then the debt would be dealt with. That's good accounting. Whereas this man, in verse 30, it says that instead he went off and had the man thrown into prison until he could pay the debt. You actually can't pay a debt in prison, can you? You're just there forever. You're sort of stuck there. At least the master was not going to be stuck in a sort of a never-ending cycle of unforgiveness, always waiting for this man to pay back what he couldn't. In fact, instead, he was going to sell the man and his possessions. He was going to make as good as he could of what the situation was. This man, however, when he sees his fellow servant, doesn't do that. He doesn't even give him an opportunity. It's almost like he doesn't want the debt to ever be paid. It's almost like he wants to hold on to it in a way. Do you notice? He doesn't cancel. He doesn't forgive. He doesn't show patience. Did you notice the words of that man too? Have patience. The very thing he had asked for. Wouldn't it be a different parable if he had asked his fellow servant for patience and that servant had gone, that's what I asked the master for. And when I asked the master for patience, he didn't give me patience. He actually cancelled my debt. What a different parable that would have been if he had learnt from the situation. But he doesn't. He seeks sort of revenge, really. And this is in capitals, forever. It's not good bookkeeping. Bookkeeping every financial year has to come to a close. This man didn't want it to ever close. He wanted to hold on to it. Anyway, there's some other fellow servants who see all this and they're a little bit concerned by their fellow servant's attitude in all of this. And so they go to the master, don't they? And they dob on him. They say, that guy who had this massive debt who you just cancelled the whole lot. Somebody else has owed him a not insignificant but very small debt in comparison. And he's had him thrown into prison. It's not fair. And it's not, is it? There's this sort of expectation. Sometimes we don't have a lot of forgiveness in us. We don't have a lot of love. We don't have a lot of grace. We don't have a lot of good things that we should have in us. And yet the way it seems to work is that when we've experienced those things, then we somehow have the resources within us. It's whether we choose to use it the way that it's been used when we received it. And so verse 34, it takes a really, really dark turn. In anger, his master turned him over to the jailers to be tortured until he could pay back all he owed. Just very briefly, some versions don't even mention that he was tortured. It just says that he was handed over to the jailers. In the NIV, it says that he was turned over to the jailers to be tortured. The reality is that the original text doesn't mention jailers and it doesn't mention torture. Let me give you a literal translation. The master or the king delivered him to the tormentors. That's what it says. He delivered him to the tormentors until he should pay. Now, the interesting thing is that the king, who liked to tie things off at the end of the financial year, it was very different to this servant who was happy to sit in this place of revenge forever and ever. It almost looks like the master is now changed the way he does things to fit in to this other servant now. This other servant wanted his fellow servant to be sort of caught in a trap forever as a result of his debt. Whereas this master was the sort of master who released people from their debt, cancelled. But with this gentleman now, he actually says, well, you will be trapped now. You wanted to live under this system, didn't you? This system of perpetual bookkeeping that never ends, never has an end of financial year where debts are written off. You wanted to be in this forever. And you made that clear by the way you treated your fellow servants. So now that you've made it clear that this is the system you want to be under, the master says, I'll deliver you over to the tormentors until you should pay and you can be in this system yourself. The master actually delivers him to the system that is the system he wants to live by when it comes to those who owe him. It's a really interesting turn in the end. I find it really interesting the way that the master sort of delivers him to the tormentors. And one of the things that we often have, so we come to the end in verse 35, you know, this is how my heavenly father will treat each of you unless you forgive your brother from your heart. And we might say, ah, yes, this is the God that we believe in, the God who sends people to hell. Now, I'm not saying God doesn't send people to hell, but I think it's important with the parable to look at what he actually does do rather than before we just jump into that. He delivers him over to the system that he has demanded to be in. And that is a system where he torments endlessly those around him by not forgiving them, if he can. Some people it won't make any difference to. But ultimately, he torments himself. He's the one who's trapped in the system. Of the three people in the parable, he is the one who chose to stay in that system. And so the master goes, well, I will hand you over to the torments of being in this system. This torments, and you might say, what torments? What torments are there of demanding, of being unforgiving, of not releasing people from the debt, of what they owe you? Because we like getting what we owe. Well, just think about it for a second. Unforgiveness is torture. And you might think you're torturing the person you're not forgiving, but you're actually torturing yourself. You don't let go. Let me repeat, you do not let go. You hold on to this. It drags you down. You are embittered over time. You are not satisfied. You want more. It's not a good system. The master had the good idea. He had the right idea. Let's close this off. Let's just sell you and your family and everything you own, and then we can just end a financial year. It's done. No, that's too much. I'll cancel the debt. The king at each point, the master at each point, you notice how he's not trapped in something? You notice he's not in this perpetual thing that goes on forever and ever? But there's a wicked servant who is. We make much, and I'm not saying God doesn't send people to hell, but we make much of a God who sends people to hell at times. And yet we choose hell. Millions of people choose hell. Every day. And so I want to encourage you this morning to be free. Because you can forgive. And there's some things I really need to say about forgiveness, such as you can forgive and not be in the same room as the person. If there's somebody who's hurt you so much, there's somebody who's been abusive in your life, you don't have to be there in front of that person to forgive them, but you can. Because it's something that you do in your heart. Did you notice that? At that last little bit in verse 35. This is how my heavenly Father will treat each of you unless you forgive your brother from your heart. It's also worth noting that the person who has wronged you doesn't have to ask for forgiveness. That actually comes out in the parable as well. Did you notice that? He didn't ask for forgiveness. He didn't ask for cancelling of his debt. He asked for patience. But the master chose to forgive him. Forgiveness is always in your power to do. It's not waiting for somebody else to apologize. Another thing about forgiveness is you can forgive and restrict the contact that that person has with you. You can have boundaries in place if that person has hurt you and you don't want that to happen again. Forgiveness does not condone anything. When you forgive somebody, it doesn't say it was okay. In fact, I hope by how hard it might be sometimes for us to forgive somebody in our hearts, it says that it's not okay. Maybe it does feel like 200,000 years worth of wages are owed to you. But we're called to forgive our brother from our heart, which really means I really need to finish by just reminding us that this is something that in and of our broken selves we will struggle to do. It's a hard thing to do. I dare say it's a near impossible thing for us to do. But just like we love because God first loved us, we also show grace because God first showed grace to us. And we also forgive because God has forgiven us. And that's what Jesus says, isn't it? In fact, that's what this parable says. Remember, it could have been a very different parable if instead of doing what he did, this servant had instead said, oh, I know what it's like to be forgiven. I know what it's like to have your debt cancelled. I would like to see what it's like to do that for somebody. If we're finding it hard to forgive, then the best advice I could give any of us is to sit and remind yourself of the debt that you have already been forgiven by your Heavenly Father, who sent his Son, who sold him into slavery, that you and I might live. We're going to come to the table in a minute. And this is a great thing to come to the table with, this idea that we have been forgiven much. And so this morning, each time we come to the table, we've got the opportunity maybe to think of something slightly different. And maybe this morning it might be a great opportunity to come to the table with somebody who owes you. Come to the table with somebody who owes you this morning. And in your heart, as you look at what Christ has done for you, maybe you can forgive them. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your love. We thank you for Jesus Christ, and we thank you for the forgiveness of sins we have through him. We thank you, Lord, that you did not stick to the books. Indeed, you were willing to throw them out because your love for us was greater than good accounting. And so we thank you for that. We pray, Lord, that as we come to this table this morning, we would be reminded of your forgiveness. Work in our hearts, Lord, that we might be able to forgive. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, we're going to sing a very appropriate hymn, which is 407, which is "Just As I Am Without One Plea, But That You Died to Set Me Free."
Set me free, and as your
We have the opportunity to make a statement of some of the things that we believe in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Well, as we come to the table this morning, I am working on the assumption that you received some juice and crackers on the way in. So we gather here this morning to do something that Jesus asked us to do as his disciples and followers of him. That as we gather together, that we would remember that he is the bread of life, that his blood was poured out for us. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we join together now as your brothers and sisters and bought at the great price of your own life. We thank you for the love that you have shown to us through this act of sacrifice. Even though you had done nothing wrong and were without sin, you hung on a cross for our sake. Your body was broken and your blood was shed that we might live. You alone are righteous, and we confess that we fall short of who you have created us to be. We are in your debt. We know that we cannot come and take part in this supper through anything that we have done. Indeed, this supper is because we were unable to help ourselves. We pray that as we take part in this supper, that you would remind us that our spiritual survival depends upon you. Without your spirit within us, we are hungry, we remain thirsty. Without your spirit within us, we die. And so we come now to remind ourselves that each and every day we have life through you living inside of us. And we thank you, Jesus, for this gift of life. Amen. Well, Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, he took some bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body that was given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup and again, giving thanks, gave it to the disciples, saying, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant that is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." I invite each and every one of you to eat and drink with us together. There is no restriction on who can join in this meal. Jesus made no requirements or qualifications. And so if you would like the opportunity to experience the grace that is freely offered, then I invite you to eat and to drink. So take and eat to remember that Christ has died for you, and be thankful. Jesus said, I tell you, I will not drink of this fruit of the vine from now on until that day when I drink it anew with you in my Father's kingdom. So drink this in remembrance that Christ's blood was shed for you, and be thankful. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you feed us who receive these holy mysteries with the spiritual food of the body and blood of our Saviour, Jesus Christ. And we thank you for this assurance of your goodness and love. We are living members of his body and heirs of his eternal kingdom. We thank you that we can share this meal together, not only as a symbol of our union with you, but also with one another. In Jesus' name. Final hymn for this morning, which is a great hymn to sing after having been to the table and received the grace. 386. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me.
Save a wretch like me.
as a retiring offering. Let me pray for that. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your goodness, your grace, your mercy, the forgiveness that you have lavished upon us. We ask that our gifts, now given freely, might be used by you for the extension of your kingdom and for your glory. Amen. Well, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit bless, preserve, and keep you. The Lord mercifully with his favour look upon you and fill you with all spiritual benediction and grace, that in this life and in the world to come you may be partakers of eternal life. Amen.